Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Field of Dreams movie site. We are so honored that you are here today and that we are joined by the top decision makers in Major League Baseball who know the value of this place. And those of you who are local, who are neighbors, fellow folks from Dyersville, you know how beautiful this place is and how special it has become over the last 27 years. So I'd invite you to take a seat, if you haven't already, and enjoy this afternoon's program. What you're going to hear is something historic. Obviously, it's the first time a standing Major League Baseball commissioner has come to the Field of Dreams. So we're very honored that Commissioner Rob Manfred is here with us today and the rest of his leadership team. What I'd like you to do is pay attention to the monitors on either side of me, because what you're going to see are images that baseball has emblazoned in our minds for years, for decades. And you're going to hear a very familiar voice, and I'll let you guess who that is. But now I just ask you to turn your attention to the monitors on the side and enjoy the rest of the program.
Ray? People will come, Ray. They'll come to Iowa for reasons they can't even fathom. They'll turn up your driveway, not knowing for sure why they're doing it. They'll arrive at your door as innocent as children, longing for the past. Oh, of course, we won't mind if you look around, you'll say. It's only $20 per person. And they'll pass over the money without even thinking about it. For it's money they have, and peace they lack. And they'll walk out to the bleachers, sit in shirt sleeves on a perfect afternoon. They'll find they have reserved seats somewhere along one of the baselines, where they sat when they were children and cheered their heroes. And they'll watch the game, and it'll be as if they dipped themselves in magic waters. The memories will be so thick, they'll have to brush them away from their faces. People will come, Ray. The one constant through all the years, Ray, has been baseball. America has rolled by like an army of steamrollers. It has been erased like a blackboard, rebuilt and erased again. But baseball has marked the time. This field, this game, it's a part of our past, Ray. It reminds us of all that once was good and could be good again. Oh, people will come, Ray. People will most definitely come.
Why can't I speak like that? Hall of Famer Vin Scully, 67 years the voice of the Dodgers, one of my broadcast idols, tied to a moment in my favorite baseball movie, Field of Dreams. My name is Greg Amsinger. I'm from MLB Network. I also want to welcome everyone watching right now live on MLB.com throughout the country. We're here in Dyersville, Iowa, the movie site of Field of Dreams. We're thrilled to be here for a special announcement regarding the Hall of Fame tour, which is also called We Are Baseball. Now, before we get into the announcement, there are partners that we must thank for being here and making something like this happen. The tour, the Hall of Fame tour, couldn't be possible without IMAX, Major League Baseball Advanced Media, Tom Werner, CAA, United Talent Agency, Grand Slam Productions, Jaunt Virtual Reality, with content provided by our friends, the National Baseball Hall of Fame and Museum. Now, we also want to thank the actual Field of Dreams, the people that put this together. For all of you locals to come here constantly, I'm jealous of that too. Denise Stillman, who works tirelessly to make this happen for us, State Representative Nancy Dunkel, Dyersville Mayor Dan Willenborg, and we can't overlook someone who I just met moments ago, who's celebrating a special birthday today. This is her childhood home. She was born and raised here. She still cares deeply for it, works as part of the Field of Dreams team today. Happy birthday, Betty Beckenstead. A round of applause for Betty. Now I want to give you the first part of our announcement for the Hall of Fame tour, and that is where it will begin. And it's going to begin just 90 miles from where we're sitting right now, just 90 miles away. All of you in attendance can go. It's going to start July 3rd. The city of Davenport will host the first stop of this historic combination of baseball's history and the game's technology. It's the marriage of the two that's making this so special. For that to happen, we thank Davenport Mayor Frank Klipsch, Quad Cities owner Dave Heller. But again, Davenport's where it's starting. So that's one of the six. So one city down, five more to reveal for you. In 2016, the Hall of Fame Tour will visit Kansas City, Milwaukee, the Twin Cities, St. Louis, and yes, Las Vegas. So like you needed another reason to go visit Las Vegas, it'll be there for you. Now the full slate of cities in 2017, that's gonna be announced at a later date. I don't wanna lose that. Now this tour, like I said, it's being driven by technology. It's making it so much cooler than ever before. Like virtual reality, mixing artifacts with virtual reality, a special IMAX presentation, really to immerse all of you, the loyal baseball fans, into a larger than life experience. You know, it might not be Iowa, but it's pretty close to baseball heaven, I'd say. Now, for more on the Hall of Fame tour, let's take a look at this video. Watch.
Eight decades after its inaugural class, the Baseball Hall of Fame remains the central nervous system for the game's illustrious history. With 312 inductees and thousands of iconic artifacts spanning generations, each year hundreds of thousands flock to its home in central New York State to wrap themselves in the tapestry of the game's greatest achievements. Beginning in 2016, the legends housed in Cooperstown will come alive in your city. The Baseball Hall of Fame Tour is a state-of-the-art traveling baseball exhibit born out of a desire to deliver fans access to a once-in-a-lifetime Hall of Fame experience. But more than just featuring the artifacts and imagery that tie together the past and present of the world's greatest game, the Baseball Hall of Fame Tour is poised to offer levels of immersive and interactive engagement never before available, conceived and crafted with cutting-edge technologies. Dozens of artifacts, hundreds of iconic images and footage, high-definition touchscreen displays, customized experiences, and virtual reality featuring today's greatest stars. Fans will also be treated to never-before-seen content in a unique mobile IMAX theater with a baseball movie created exclusively for the tour by the magical filmmakers at IMAX. Let your baseball imagination go. The stories, the traditions, the very essence of baseball. It will all be displayed and exhibited in new and exciting ways, and it's coming to your city beginning this summer.
This is a big deal, the Hall of Fame Tour, We Are Baseball. For more on it, I want to welcome a very special guest. He's excited to be here. Baseball Commissioner Rob Manfred joins me up on the set. Take a seat and we'll have a chat. I wore the shirt first. He was second.
Yeah, I don't know about that, actually.
Okay. So, Commissioner, here we are. Field of Dreams, the movie site. You're the first baseball commissioner to be here. Can you believe that?
It is interesting that I'm the first one to visit. It's such an amazing place. I have to tell you, I've been excited about this visit all week. I started Monday. I watched the MLB Network special on the 25th anniversary, and then I watched the movie again, probably about the 25th time, but I just wanted to make sure I was sharp before I got here.
I did the same thing last night.
Yeah. And it's a good way to spend a night.
It really is, no question about it. And you notice things when you walk through the house. We were given a tour. I'm sure all of you have been inside of it, how small the kitchen is. Kevin Costner comes barreling through. You know, the one of the earlier scenes in the movie. The fridge looks so tiny. Right. Everything's smaller when you walk through. What'd you think of the tour?
Well, the tour was really interesting. I mean, it's amazing how close to what you remember from the movie it all looks the same. It's just, I think, brings back a lot of memories about the movie and some of the things that you really love about the film.
The Hall of Fame tour. I wish this existed when I was a kid growing up in the Midwest. I really do. How long have you guys been working on making this happen?
This has been in the works for several years. There were a number of people, Tom Werner, Bob Bowman from MLB Advanced Media, that really worked hard on the idea from its infancy. And I think the idea of taking another baseball shrine, Cooperstown, and making it mobile, so that people around the country have a more realistic opportunity to share in the experience, is just a great idea.
Now, for people at home that want more details, you know, when you go to Cooperstown, you walk through, you'll see a glove, and it looks old, it looks really neat, and then you read about it. This is essentially getting an experience before the reveal of the artifact in many ways, right?
Right, and I think that for us, the opportunity to combine technology with an iconic location like Cooperstown was appealing. We thought would be more appealing to young people, or especially appealing to young people, and I think important to the game overall.
And for people watching right now, getting youth into baseball, the Play Ball initiative that you are really all about, why is it that's always been the first thing that you wanted to talk about once you took over as commissioner?
Well, I think that baseball's always been generational. And I think the most important and most fundamental obligation for those of us who are fortunate enough to have an opportunity to work in the game is to make sure that the game gets passed on to the next generation the same way it was passed on to us. And if you think about, you know, my kids, your kids, it's a different world out there. There are a lot of other entertainment and sports alternatives, and I think play ball, the initiative Play Ball, is our recognition that we have to work really hard to be competitive with young people to make sure that baseball stays as popular going forward as it is today.
Our sport has many strengths. One would be the history, obviously. And the other that I don't know if a lot of people really understand is the cutting-edge technology that Major League Baseball has invested in, right?
When I started, I sort of sat around for a couple of days, and you know, you figure out what do you have to work with, and you know, obviously, first and most important is our game. Our game is, for me, still the best game in the world, and it is the core of everything we do. But right after that, on our list of assets came MLB Advanced Media. I think particularly when you're focused on appealing to young people, having a world-class technology company as one of your assets is, you know, you drew the long straw on that one, and I certainly did draw the long straw in terms of Advanced Media.
Now, you grew up in the Northeast, right?
I did.
So you had a chance to go to Cooperstown probably at a young age.
I grew up about 50 minutes from Cooperstown, so that was sort of a day jaunt for us, not even a weekend jaunt. So I went to Cooperstown, I can't even tell you how many times as a kid, but I still enjoy going back, and it's one of the reasons that I thought this project was so important, to give more people an opportunity to see and share in the great history of our game.
And because a lot of people here, I'm sure, raise your hand if you've never been to Cooperstown. A lot of people in the Midwest just don't have a chance to go do that. So take us back to the first time you went to Cooperstown. Describe it, because when this tour comes, it's only going to be 90 miles away. They're going to get a taste of what you experienced as a young kid.
Well, you know, it's not just people in the Midwest that it's hard to get to Cooperstown. Cooperstown's hard to get to from most parts
right.
of New York.
From Manhattan, yeah.
Right. Not that easy to get there. What I remember was walking through and the breadth of the exhibits. There's so many interesting that some people would think of as non-baseball pieces to the exhibit. For example, Babe Ruth's club championship trophy from the golf club he belonged to in New York is in the Hall of Fame. I mean, just really interesting, sort of offbeat historical pieces, in addition to, you know, all the most memorable things. But it is a fantastic collection in Cooperstown, and it's one of those collections that you can go back to over and over again and see something different each time that you go.
Now, there are some jealous fans out there right now because they were probably pulling that for their city to be one of the stops along the tour. How were those cities, how did they come up?
The selection of the cities was a really difficult thing to do in terms of the first year in particular. You know, our focus, someone smarter than I had the idea of starting here and kind of building around a Midwestern core, if you know, with the exception of Las Vegas, all really Midwestern cities. And I think that's a great idea. You don't want to be too close to Cooperstown. So many great baseball fans, particularly in the center of our country. But I think more important than the ones that are going to be fortunate enough to have the exhibit this year is our commitment to continue to bring it to other cities around the country as we move forward.
Some of the details of the tour, I mean, an IMAX is involved, so that's initially cool. And I'm hearing like historical selfies you can take.
Yeah, the interactive experiences are amazing. I think the virtual reality pieces, if you haven't experienced virtual reality and this is your first opportunity, I think you'll be really impressed by what you see as part of the exhibit. And again, the idea of marrying up a first-time technology-based experience like virtual reality with our game, I think is really important in terms of appealing to people like these nice kids that are sitting out here.
I was just about to bring that up. You kind of, like, you really got excited to go talk to them. John Smoltz went and chatted with them. You've been around going, checking out youth baseball all over the country. Are you seeing a groundswell? Are you picking up steam with play ball?
I think that probably the most encouraging thing about my first year was the traction that we felt for our youth initiative. I'll give you a couple of great examples. We did a partnership with the U.S. Conference of Mayors. We collected, as a result of a 5-minute speech, which I can tell you was uninspiring because I gave it, okay?
Oh,
but we got 140 pledges, I think, from mayors around the country to hold play ball events in the month of August last year, and all 140 of those pledges were fulfilled. We had some great events during August. The people who are active in the youth space, Steve Keener at Little League, Cal Ripken, the Pony League, really excited about the idea of Major League Baseball providing leadership, support, financing for youth efforts.
And the thing that a lot of people don't know is the Play Ball Initiative, it's not about, you know, intense practices, you know, games that you need 8 teammates to play. You want kids going out there, taking a few cuts in a cage, you know, playing catch, softball, whatever it is, many different ways to play the game.
That's right. I mean, particularly the U.S. The Conference of Mayors events are designed really to show kids that you don't need 18 kids and umpires and parents in the stands to play baseball, to engage with our game. It's designed to get back to sort of a simpler way, the way that I remember playing baseball as a kid. You know, however many guys you had, you figured out a way to play. Mm-hmm. We think that's really important and really is the backbone of the development of the next generation of fans.
I like We Are Baseball, by the way. Who came up with that?
I don't know who came up with that one, to tell you the truth. I think that one was actually might have been Hall of Fame work product, but
okay.
I'm not sure.
Well, speaking of Hall of Fame, we actually have a Hall of Famer with us. You've saw him pitch for years with the Atlanta Braves. One of my great friends at MLB Network. I want to bring up onto the stage John Smoltz, everyone. John was showing off his knuckle curve to the youngster that had to catch that earlier. John, can you believe you're at Field of Dreams, one of your favorite movies?
It is pretty cool. A lot cooler than trying to throw from 60 feet 6 inches again. That's not fun for me.
No,
shoulder's pretty much done. It was really neat to put on an old-time glove, to experience just a little bit of history, even though the movie depicted so much of what our game is about.
How did you do with that glove, by the way?
I didn't catch as well as I thought I was going to catch, that's for sure. It's not exactly one of those you can quick snatch a baseball. You got to make sure it hits the one spot that's there for you to catch, because there ain't much there.
Yeah, you dropped a couple.
I did.
But I can't imagine anyone catching with that. You know, what's really cool about having John here is John, a lot of people don't know this, but you never went to Cooperstown until the induction weekend, right?
Yeah.
The year before for the Tom Glavine and Greg Maddux.
The year before, covering it for the network, I got a sneak preview of a place that – now, I'd been there as a kid in the Junior Olympics playing against China, Taipei, playing on the field – but never really experienced the essence of what the Hall of Fame is about, the actual inside, the artifacts, all the memories of the game that was played before me. And so when I was with the network and got a chance to see my teammates, Glavine and Maddux, and my manager, Bobby Cox, get inducted, the smile on my face was beyond belief because it was like getting a chance to see your family member do something special. And never realized what Cooperstown was till I got that experience with the network. I'd never seen, you know, as a player, we play throughout the year. You can't watch it. You're playing. You know, it's the season's a long season. So you never get a chance to really appreciate what goes on. And then when I was done playing, to see that firsthand, I tell people all the time, if you can make it happen, if there's a bucket list item and you're a baseball fan, you've got to find a way. It is the most unique place in the world.
It's one of my favorite parts of my job is induction weekend up in Cooperstown. But Commissioner Rob Manfred, is it stressful for you because you have to read the plaque and sit there up on stage? Is it a relaxing experience for you?
You know, my reading skills are actually above average. So, it's not like I'm giving a speech. All I got to do is read what somebody else wrote. So it's not the toughest day of the year, to tell you the truth.
It's hot. You got your sunglasses on. And yeah. It's an easy day, I guess you're right. But for the fan experience, there's nothing like it. Everyone's there. John, you have to admit, you were a little nervous last year, right? Just a little bit?
I was way nervous. I did not expect the call to come in my first year. I think that's the way I approach everything. I was never one that listened to what, you know, people were saying because you just set yourself up for something no need to do. And, look, I don't get carried away with much, and I've had a phenomenal career with the excitement of the Atlanta Braves. But to get that call is something it's like this movie. It's like a dream of a lifetime. And I remember just getting the call and being numb. And my wife was on the other end trying to, you know, waiting for some kind of emotion. And I just said, that's great. Thank you. And basically, goodbye. She said, who was that? So that was the Hall of Fame. I just made it. And she goes, way to tip me off and give me some kind of – I just was numb. And to be there as a player – obviously, it's one thing as a broadcaster, but to be there as a player in front of all those people, I tell people all the time, it wasn't the 15 to 20 to 30,000 people there that makes you, I mean, that's unbelievable and awesome. It's the people behind you. When you're standing up giving your speech, you realize those behind you have done things and set the game and been part of the game. It's so hard to explain. It is that speech was not easy for me.
Can I ask him a question about his speech?
Please.
You know, you alluded to this when we were talking to the kids before, and I'd love to hear you talk about it again because you talked about it in your induction speech about participation in sports generally and specialization in sports. I think for the young people here to hear you talk about that would be a really valuable thing.
Yeah, I had an opportunity, one of the greatest platforms in the world in the Hall of Fame, to say what I was passionate about. And youth sports, I'm passionate about. I love coaching them. I love being around it as much as I can. But people have gotten into a little bit of a misconceived notion that you have to play one sport all year to become a professional baseball or basketball or football, and it's just simply not true. I loved where I grew up. Seasonal changes meant seasonal sports. I played three of them, and the opportunity to play sports and get outdoors is one of the greatest things that kids have. I know there's a lot of distractions, a lot of technology, but playing year-round in places like the South and the West where you can do it just is not as advantageous as people think. The history of injuries, all the things that go on. That's why places like here in Michigan and the Midwest, getting an opportunity to play seasonal sports and being athletic is something that parents, you just don't understand how much time your children have. And as a player who grew up and loved sports and got a chance to play multiple sports. It is the reason why I was able to play baseball as long as I did, and it's the reason why, for the most part, I stayed as healthy as I did, because I didn't consume myself with one sport 1 year, and that's it. And I think we got to reverse the trend. We really do. So many great athletes, so many great baseball players today, but I want to see them play as long as they can, and year-round baseball is going to cripple the opportunity for many kids to play this game as long as they can.
And we want to watch John Smoltz play multiple sports for as long as he can. You are playing sports year-round still. You're still a 14-year-old, John.
I still am a 14-year-old trapped in a 49-year-old body. I play basketball, and I play a lot of golf, and every chance I can get outdoors and do something active. And I'm traveling a lot, obviously covering this great game of baseball, broadcasting now, and that's a challenge to fit that in. And I never wanted to lose that feeling of being a kid. I really didn't.
Where'd you grow up again?
Lansing, Michigan.
Lansing, Michigan. Imagine at the age of 12, the Hall of Fame tour, We Are Baseball, comes to Lansing, Michigan. And you get to go and be interactive in a mobile Cooperstown, essentially, where you get to do touch screens and slide graphics. And now you get the big reveal, and that's Ty Cobb's glove or bat. Imagine what that would have done to a young John Smoltz.
Well, imagine what it would do to me right now. I just think the opportunity so fresh of being in the Hall of Fame. You know, to get to a place in a city where you would get the chance to – I call it a tease. It's a great tease. It's a tease of seeing some artifacts and seeing some history that the game has. And then if you get the opportunity maybe to see the full end picture or getting a chance to go to Cooperstown. But what a unique opportunity that most people wouldn't have. And they can drive a little bit less to get that picture in their mind of what it's like to see some of the greats before me. When I went on my personal tour – I was in awe. I thought I knew the game a little bit, and I thought I knew some of those who were before me. Mm-hmm. But to actually see things and hold the bat of maybe Babe Ruth or see the cleats, and you start picturing in your mind what the game was like back then, that's what I thought the movie did a great job of, just even taking us way back and seeing the differences today versus back then, and see the glove, to see the hat, the uniforms. Man, I'm glad I didn't wear some of those uniforms.
Right?
Woo! Yeah, that would have been hot.
A day like today, especially.
Yeah.
Commissioner Rob Manfred, when you think about a city like St. Louis or Milwaukee or the reaction this is going to get in Las Vegas, what do you expect?
Well, I expect, you know, Milwaukee and St. Louis, you're talking about two real baseball towns. I think that you'll see a tremendous turnout in cities like that for this particular exhibit. The strength of the game in those markets will really drive attendance. Las Vegas, a little different story. I think that, you know, I think it'll do great. It'll do great because you have visitors from all around the world that are going to be there trying to do a variety of things in Las Vegas. But I think this is one of those exhibits that can hold its own with any attraction.
No question about that. I still, every time I look at John and I see you, Mr. Commissioner, sitting next to him, I think of the wig. The wig he put on during his induction speech.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, that was an unfortunate moment. Actually,
it was something he teased. He let me know that there was going to be a big reveal the night before.
Yeah, I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid, and that's part of what made me who I was as a baseball player. But I wanted to bring a unique perspective of time, and obviously my teammates previously, I felt like it was a John Smoltz roast in their induction speech, as Glavin got me, Maddox got me, Bobby not so much, being my manager. So I, if I was fortunate enough, the next year I started planning, if I get the call, what can I do? You know, how do I make this something special? So it was a last-minute call. I didn't think I was going to be able to do it. It's the Hall of Fame, you know. And I felt for just a moment, people are going to get the sense of who I really am. I'm a fierce competitor. I love the game. And yet, at the same time, there's that Dumb and Dumber in me, you know, one of my favorite movies.
Oh, yeah, we know.
And so yeah. I put on the wig to show what I once had and to get back at my two teammates, Glavin, more Maddox than Glavin. I was able to deliver what hopefully was a perfectly timed and at the same time get me away from the emotion of that speech that was starting to really take its toll. And so it was a great – it came off about as well as I could have hoped, at least – probably the only wig that's ever been at the Hall of Fame and the speech. And if I had to do it all over again, the only thing I would have done different maybe is spoke some Spanish to lighten the load for Pedro Martinez.
Right, yeah, I don't think you needed that. There was plenty of that. Finally, John, you're still competitive with Tom Glavine and Greg Maddux, fellow Hall of Famers, longtime teammates. They got to be pretty jealous that you're sitting here in Field of Dreams. The house is right behind you, man. What a charm life. Great experience, huh?
No, it really is. I've been places that I never thought were possible, out of Lansing, Michigan, small city, and I've got a chance to be part of some of the greatest moments in sports, have dinner with the president. I mean, you name it. For a guy who started out playing the accordion when he was 4 years old, this has been a really cool journey, and this marks it off as another moment that I would have never had it not been for some of the things we talked about.
There you have Hall of Famer John Smoltz, Baseball Commissioner Rob Manfred. My name is Greg Amsinger. Thank you all so much for coming out and watching on MLB.com.